In this video, you want to take a quick look at one of the simplest and most useful circuits that we can build called the voltage divider. It's made with usually just two resistors and some kind of a power supply. In our case, usually we're going to be using a battery. So it really in the end consists of only three components: a source, which is a battery, and two resistors. As is indicated in this slide, the voltage divider, this simple configuration, can end up being the key to a lot of big ideas. It can be an easy way to learn some basic circuit phenomena. So as an introduction to circuits, it's really useful. And as it says on the bottom, we can use it to understand a lot of the fundamentals of circuits and other kinds of linear systems, with the example being Ohm's law. In this video, and possibly some others, there'll be several points where you're encouraged to pause and think about a question. To do this, you'll have to push pause, which is found on the lower left on the YouTube window. And then when you're ready to proceed, after you've given some thought to how you want to answer the question, then you go ahead and start the video again. You'll be reminded of this with the symbol shown here, which is the pause play button symbol and a finger touching it to just indicate that you should be pushing this button. All right, so we want to begin by looking at the voltage divider. And if you look up the voltage divider, you find that one of the fundamental ideas that you really have to start from is Ohm's law. So if we look up Ohm's law on Wikipedia, it's found in many different forms, but two of the forms that we'll be using here are indicated as shown, where we have V equals IR and I equals V over R. In other words, if you have a resistor, as is shown over here, and there's a current I flowing through it, there will be a voltage V across the resistor. If on the other hand you have a resistor R and a voltage V across it, you'll get a current I given by the voltage divided by the resistance. It all depends upon what you're actually given in terms of what you're going to calculate. Now, one of the more useful ways of looking at this, because these relationships involve constants, you know, the voltage and current are related by a constant, that is the resistance, that if you plot voltage versus current, you should get a straight line, as is shown in the two figures below. So here I have voltage on the horizontal scale and current on the vertical scale. Okay. And so if you happen to have a large resistance, then the slope is going to be fairly small. If you have a small resistance, the slope will be fairly large, because we're plotting current versus voltage, not voltage versus current. And so the higher the resistance, the lower the slope. And one of the things we can use is actually plot out. We can measure the current under different voltage conditions, and the slope of that line will give us the resistance. The slope is 1 over the resistance. Okay. Things to keep in mind here. Whenever you have a large resistor, you get a small current. Whenever you have a small resistor, you get a large current, that is assuming the same voltage. This is important to keep in mind. So anytime you have a system with very large resistors, you know the currents are small. And anytime you have a system with very small resistors, then the currents will be relatively large. Okay, so here's the voltage divider circuit. It consists of two resistors, as I've indicated before, R1 and R2. It has an input voltage of some kind or other, and it produces an output voltage, which is actually measured at a point between the two resistors. So if we put in some kind of an input voltage, say from a battery or a power supply of some kind or other, then the output voltage will be smaller and be given by a function of the resistances. And what is that function? It's shown here. So the output voltage is equal to the input voltage times the bottom resistor in the numerator over the sum of the two resistors. Note, one special case here to consider is that if these two resistors are identical, and let's go back to the figure for a second. If the two resistors are identical, then the voltage, the output voltage right here, should be half of the input voltage, because you're going to end up with exactly the same voltage across both of those resistances. Another thing to keep in mind is that the voltage divider actually only works, the idea works here because there is a current flowing through the circuit, and the same current flows through R1 and R2. So the current through R1 and the current through R2 are the same, and it's actually the current coming from the source. That implies that we really can't have any real current going to the output, and in this case we're just measuring the output, so there's no current going to the output. So keep in mind, the voltage divider will only work as long as the exact same current flows through the two resistances. Okay. So where does this formula come from? So let's take a look at the circuit here, and I've had it drawn slightly differently, and I'm actually showing you what the outcome should be, and what we want to do is go ahead and derive that. Okay, so what I've drawn here is I've redrawn the circuit for taking into account something that I'm hoping that you've already reviewed with someone, and that is that if you combine two resistors in series, here we have two resistors in series, that the combination ends up just being the sum of the two resistances. So the circuit on the right is exactly the same as the circuit on the left, except we've combined the two resistors into a single resistor. So now we have a voltage across a resistor, and so the current, I, is V divided by R, which is just V in, divided by R1 plus R2. Okay, so anytime you have a voltage across the resistance, in this case it's the combination of the two resistors, that the current is just the voltage divided by the resistance. And so the current flowing in the circuit, which goes all the way around this loop here, all in this direction, is Vn divided by R1 plus R2. Okay, so I've rewritten the expression for the current as Vn over R1 plus R2. And now what we want to do is we want to know what the voltage is right here, what V out is. And so I've written this expression, which is just Ohm's law, that says if I know the current going through that resistor, I know that the voltage is the current times the resistance. And if I just plug these things in, I get Vn times R2 over R1 plus R2. Didn't quite come out right, which is exactly this expression right here. So all we really had to do this was, let's go back. I just had to combine the two resistors into a single resistor, and then I end up with the current. If I know the current through if I want to know the voltage across a resistor, all I have to do is multiply the current times the resistance, and I'm all set, and I have the expression. Okay, now that we've actually seen where the expression comes from, let's go ahead and see if we can find some useful ways of using it. Okay, so remember that what we were doing was, in the normal application of this, is that we're given Vin, and R1 and R2. So we have the known quantities that are right here, and we use that to calculate what the output voltage should be. But is it possible to use, here we have an expression with four parameters in it, Vout, Vin, R1, and R2. Is there another way, or are there other ways that we can use this formula? And from the symbol, you can tell this is a good point to stop and think about it. So go ahead and pause for a moment. Okay, so now we're back, and if you've been thinking about this a little bit, maybe you recognize immediately that if you've got four unknowns, if we can measure any three, we can probably determine the fourth. All right, so what does that mean? It means we can do this. If Vin is unknown, let's take for example that we don't know what a battery voltage actually is, we can measure the output voltage and then know the two resistances, and we'll be able to figure what the input voltage is. You may wonder why you would want to bother doing that. But let's take, for example, a case where the battery might be a higher voltage than you can actually measure with whatever device you have. So use the voltage divider to make it smaller so that it's within the range of application of the device you're using to make the measurement. You have the other two options. We can use this as a circuit to figure out what R1 is if we don't know what it is, and or what R2 is if we don't know what it is. All right, so we've looked at this case where we've got one unknown and three knowns. What happens if we have two unknowns or even more? Is there an experiment we can do to figure out all four parameters, for example? Let's assume we know none of these things. What kind of an experiment would we do? Okay. And are there other reasons to make more than one set of measurements, which gives you a clue as to maybe how you should go about doing this. So again, this is a point where you should stop for a minute and think about these two questions, and then we'll come back and go forward with the discussion. Okay, so if we happen to have two unknowns or even more, what experiment can we do? Well, let's say we don't know what say R1 or R2 are. Maybe these are devices we just have no idea what the resistances are, or maybe the color code is worn off of the resistors or something. All you have to do is do two experiments. You have two unknowns, so you need two equations, so you just have to do it under two different circumstances where you put in two different values for Vin and you get two different values for Vout, and then you can use those two equations to figure out what R1 and R2 are. It turns out that it's a good idea under most circumstances to make multiple measurements, not to just make one measurement. And if you've thought about this a little bit, you may realize that the most obvious thing is, what if you do it wrong? Well, you'd like to be able to do it again just to see if you possibly have made a mistake. And you know, if you do it four times and you do it right three times and wrong once, then you'll be able to recognize the time you did it wrong. You may have just read the meter wrong or something like that. So there's experimental error. There's noise, because you may just be picking up noise as you're doing the measurement. And the final thing is that you may find that the devices that you're assuming have consistent properties may be changing. Resistors will change in value as they get hot. Batteries, as they age, drop in voltage. So it's possible that any of the components in your circuit that you were assuming were known may not be known, because you've made a measurement at one time and then an hour later they actually have different properties. So the three reasons that immediately come to mind: you may make mistakes, so experimental error, noise, and the fact that you may find that the components that you're using are not consistently, do not consistently have the same value, so you need to always double check that. All right, so how do we go about using this? One of the things is was obvious above here is that if we want to know what, let's say, R1 is or R2, or we can find out what these characteristics are and then from that figure out what R1 and R2 are. So I'm actually just going to go through this as two simple cases to prepare you for doing a very simple experiment. All right, so let's assume for the moment we have a battery as a source. As I've said previously, you may not know actually what the battery voltage is. A 9-volt battery, when it's fresh, probably has a voltage of about 9.6 volts if it's a standard type of heavy-duty battery. If it's a lithium-ion battery, it might be just a little over 9 volts. It could be all sorts of numbers, and as they age, they drop in voltage. So let's assume for the moment that we don't know what Vin is and we don't know what R1 is. So we're going to assume we know this resistor, but not this one, and probably not that. Okay. It turns out one of the simplest things that we can do is using the voltage divider relationship. You can see that if R2 is gigantic, then Vout is equal to Vin. That is under open circuit conditions. This also makes intuitive sense if you think about it, because the current through R1 will be zero. So if there is no resistor, if there's nothing connected at all where R2 is, there's no current, and therefore there's no voltage across R1 either. But you just have to look at the voltage divider relationship if you don't want to get into all aspects of circuits. You can see that if R2 is very much bigger than R1, we can neglect R1, and then Vout equals Vin. So as I've indicated here, with no load at all, nothing connected at all, then Vin equals V battery equals Vout. All right. So we make one measurement like that. Now, because remember we're going to have two unknowns, we've got to make two measurements at least. Second, we're going to connect R2 with a known value to try to figure out what R1 is. Well, if we have some vague idea what R1 might be, or we just want to guess, we choose R2 to be a value similar to our guess. The reason for that is that it makes it accuracy a little bit better. Ideally, you'd really like to have the voltage in the middle, that V out, to be about half of V in, and so, but if you, let's say you're way off, you just try one and then you try another one until you begin to see a voltage that makes some kind of sense. So you connect R2, and then you determine, then you measure V out, and then you determine R1 from the voltage divider relationship. So we got V in from this measurement. We're trying to figure out what R1 is. And we know what V out is for that case. We know what R2 is, and so forth. Then we're all that's left is R1. So what is this actually going to look like? And before I do that, I have to actually erase something because it's getting too busy here. Okay, so what does the relationship look like? It looks like this. And all I've really done is just rewritten this equation up here in this form. So I've measured V battery, I measured V out with the R2 value that I've plugged in there, and I have the V out down below, and now I can figure out what R1 is. So, and this is basically what a device that measures resistance does. It just tries different values for resistance until it gets something that it can make easy sense out of. Does this answer make sense? Okay, well, all I've done is just done the algebra, but you should always do kind of a sanity check on it to see if it makes sense to you. And I think you can just go ahead and stop for a minute and think about this and then come back. Okay, so why does it make sense? Under the circumstances where R2, let's say you select an R2 that's much smaller than R1, under those circumstances, then the output voltage would be really, really small compared to the input voltage. So you're saying R2 is very much smaller than R1. So if the output voltage is really small, you could neglect this, and then you get the battery voltage divided by the output voltage, which is going to be something significantly greater than 1 times R2, which says R1 is much bigger than R2. So it's consistent, and it does make sense. So all you have to do is just try a couple of extreme cases. Where the resistor R2 is really small, under those circumstances, the R1 ends up being a lot bigger than R2. Okay, we can do exactly the same thing where the unknowns are now again the battery and R2, and you do exactly the same thing. And the only difference is because we're making a measurement across R2 for V out, the final formula looks a little different. And again, you can stop and think about whether this makes sense. And I'm not going to take time to discuss that right at this moment. Again, you should see that this does indeed make sense. Okay, so how can we use this method? We can use it to find, let's say we've got some kind of device and we have no idea what its input resistance is. I mean, it's like a black box and it acts like a resistor. What is the value? There's no indication written on it, so we can just plug it in to a circuit like this and figure it out. But where it's really, really useful is many sensors, devices that are used to sense physical parameters like light intensity or temperature or force are resistors, and their value of resistance changes as a function of whatever it is that they're measuring. So let's take a look at that, because sensors are clearly an important part of any kind of a smart system, so understanding how they work is really, really useful. Okay, so examples of the sensors here, I indicated that we could talk about light level or temperature or force or something like this. And things I'm going to look at here, the first one is a photocell whose resistance changes with light level. This is what it looks like. You may have seen these. They're not very big. If you happen to have a nightlight that turns itself on each night when the room gets dark, and if you look carefully at it, there'll be a little window inside, and you'll see inside a photocell that looks just like this. So the resistance, the resistor is actually this squiggly line here on the top, made out of metal. Its resistance gets, it does change as a function of light level, and it changes hugely. I mean, its dark resistance is about a megohm, and sometimes with a reasonable level of light, it might be as low as 1,000 ohms. So it changes over a huge range. There's also strain gauges, which are used all over the place to try to figure out how we're twisting or whatever support members and bridges and inside of aircraft and all sorts of things like that, whose resistance changes slightly when stretched or compressed. I'll come back to that in just a minute. As to why you might expect a configuration that looks something like this. Again, that's the resistor right there. And then there are force sensors where the resistance changes with pressure. Again, you can see a kind of squiggly path that the current has to flow through there. And it changes as a function of pressure. Now, something that's actually been addressed elsewhere is that resistance is if you have something that's a resistive material, its resistance will go down if you make its cross-sectional area bigger. It's kind of like water flowing in a pipe. If you make the pipe bigger, it's easier for the water to flow. If you make the pipe longer, it makes the resistance higher, because you're basically creating more friction for the, if you think about water flowing in a pipe, it's creating more friction for the water as it's flowing down the pipe. And so what's actually happening here, here's a do-it-yourself strain gauge, which is, if you actually look that up online, you'll find several examples of this. And if you find this particular figure, you'll see where I got it from, in an interesting way of making it by basically painting conductors onto a balloon. And as you stretch the balloon, so if it's stretched in this direction this way, it makes it longer, so the resistance gets higher. If you compress it so it becomes shorter in that direction, the resistance becomes lower. It doesn't change a lot, but it is enough to be able to quite accurately measure strains. And same thing happens with these other devices. In the case of the photocell, it's really a little bit different because the photons that hit it are actually creating more current carrying capability for the device. And so, you know, if there's more charges in, basically more charges in, there's better able to carry current. So more light makes the resistance go down. But in these other cases, it's almost always squishing or stretching resistors so that they go up or down. And the changes can be quite dramatic, and these are incredibly useful devices. Okay, so that basically ends this discussion of the voltage divider, because we've gotten to what is maybe the most practical application of this, and that is using the voltage divider as a sensor. In the case of the smart lighting activities that we are doing, using a photocell would be a really good application of this, where you put in a photocell for R2, its resistance changes rather dramatically, and so Vout changes a lot with the light level. And you can calibrate it against some standard device and then figure out what kind of light levels you have. Or if all you're trying to do is trigger something so it turns on when the light level is low and turns off when the light level is high, like in the nightlight that I mentioned, then this can be, again, it's a pretty common way of doing that. If you look, for example, online at experiments done with Arduinos and trying to trigger something so that it triggers on either low light levels or high light levels, and they almost always use this basic circuit to get some idea what the light levels are. And that's it for this video, and there'll be maybe one or two more that are related, but remember the basic ideas here are just related to this voltage divider. So if you have any trouble understanding how the voltage divider works, it's a good idea to discuss it with other students or anybody who's mentoring your activities, so that you understand how this works better.